To prepare this perspective, we identify a very direct consequence of the antisymmetry of the wave function of indistinguishable fermions. This is the Pauli exclusion principle, a really central principle that has far-reaching consequences. We start with it in its simplest form. For this, we utilize the asymmetry of the wave function for the specific case that the values of the labeled properties are identical, as here again specified for the example of labels 1 and 2. For electrons, this would again be position and spin. So setting these to a common value, we have the same expression on both sides, but with a relative minus sign. And this implies that the wave function has to vanish in this case. The corresponding probability density then vanishes in such a configuration too, meaning that we can never observe it. And this of course holds for any pair of labels. So put into words, we can never observe any indistinguishable fermions with the same position and intrinsic degrees of freedom. And this is already the Pauli exclusion principle in a very general form. Let us consider right away an important example, namely that of a system of two electrons. First, in words, if these electrons have the same spin, say up, then we will never be able to find them at the same position in space. But this implies that we may find the two electrons at the same position when they have an opposite spin. Still, even then, there will be a constraint on the wave function. Let us have a closer look at how this comes about. First, we consider the general form of the wave function of two particles of spin 1/2. This can be written as a four-component vector, where each component corresponds to a combination of the two spins pointing either up or down, and each of these components then depends on the positions of the two particles. Without any further constraints, this could be the wave function of a system of two distinguishable particles, such as again the electron and proton in a hydrogen atom. But if these are two electrons, this now needs to be antisymmetric under the simultaneous exchange of both the positions and the spins. Well, first of all, starting from any such wave function, we can achieve this by just writing down a manifestly antisymmetric version of it, as specified here. The only thing that we must make sure of is that this does not vanish, so that the initial wave function isn't actually symmetric to start with. Next, we would like to understand a bit better how these states look like. Essentially, what we will do is to work towards establishing a basis for these constraint states, and we will do this in two steps. First, I write down four essential combinations of such states. Three of these are antisymmetric under the exchange of the positions, but symmetric under the exchange of the spins if we do so separately. They all turn out to have an overall spin of 1, which illuminates why we find three such states, and we call them spin triplet states. The last combination is symmetric under the exchange of the positions, but antisymmetric under the exchange of the spins. This has an overall spin that vanishes and is called a spin singlet state. Secondly, to go one step further, we assume that the position-dependent part separates in the same way as we proceeded in the previous chapter when we built up the basis of a composite system. Then we can write the triplet and singlet states in the form specified here. And now we note that we can formulate the Pauli exclusion principle not just with respect to the labels of the particles, but also in terms of the labels of these single particle states. In the spin triplet states, where the spins of the particles are indistinguishable, the two single particle states cannot have the same labels. Previously, we called such labels quantum numbers. And with this insight, we are led to Pauli's original form of the exclusion principle. Two electrons cannot occupy states with the same quantum numbers, where we include the spin as one of these quantum numbers. Instead of formulating the principle in this more specific way, we can use these considerations also to generalize the Pauli exclusion principle, in that no two indistinguishable fermions can be observed having the same values for a complete set of simultaneous observables. So we can, for instance, replace position by momentum and spin up or down by the spin aligned into any direction in space. The spin singlet and triplet states of two electrons are already our first example, but let us now turn to more specific ones. The next one is mainly for illustration and concerns placing these particles into a box. As a reminder, for a single spinless particle, we defined this problem as a particle being confined into an interval of length L, in which it can move freely according to the given Hamiltonian. But the solutions were constrained by the boundary conditions, stipulating that the wave function had to vanish there. From the stationary Schrödinger equation, we then found the quantized energies and eigenstates as given here. Here I label the states by an index L so that we can keep n for the index of the particles. Now we want to consider the case that we populate this box by several electrons. When we want to use the energies of a single particle for this problem, we need to assume that there are no further energies occurring due to the interactions of these electrons. And so we are going to ignore these. In practice, this can be a relatively good approximation due to the presence of other charges that compensate the electronic charge via so-called screening. The Hamiltonian of n such electrons is then just the sum of the kinetic energies as given here. If the particles were distinguishable, we could simply separate this problem into n separate ones, analogously to what we did when we considered a single particle moving in a three-dimensional box. There, the different coordinates just had a different interpretation than here. And here we can still start from such states and then apply the anti-symmetrization procedure. To write down the resulting states in a compact form, it is useful to use the Dirac notation. First, we start out with a single electron, but include its spin. So each state is then duplicated, and we write these states as given here, where L is the orbital quantum number, and the arrows label the spin states as always. The energies of these states only depend on the orbital quantum numbers, hence they are twofold degenerate. We can call this a spin doublet. Indeed, also in the following, none of the energies will depend on the spin labels, as we have not included any spin-dependent terms into the Hamiltonian, just for simplicity. Next, for two electrons occupying two different orbital states, we obtain four states, which I therefore write here in Dirac notation. We can write these as singlet or triplet states as specified here. In all cases, the total energy will just be the sum of the orbital energies, so here all these states are degenerate. When the electrons occupy the same orbital, then their spin must be antisymmetric. So this only gives us the singlet state as written here. The ground state will be such a singlet state, as this allows us to occupy the single particle ground state twice. So now the ground state is non-degenerate. Before we develop some general statements, let's just go one step further and consider three particles, but for this just the ground state. This can be written as specified here. It's a rather long expression, but the principle is very simple. The lowest single particle state is occupied twice by electrons of opposite spin, and the remaining electron occupies the next available state, so the first excited state in the corresponding single particle problem. The spin of that additional excited electron can be chosen freely, and so this ground state exists in two variants, making it again doubly degenerate. The energy of this state is just the sum of the energies of the occupied states. As most terms in this state really just come from the antisymmetrization, it actually suffices to specify the occupations of these states. Let us enumerate these states, including the spin degree of freedom by an index I and the occupation of these states by Ni. This is 1 when we make use of this state and 0 if we don't. And this leads to a much more compact notation where the antisymmetrization of the state is simply implied. Just for information, this antisymmetrized occupation picture can be used as a starting point to formulate a theory for an arbitrary particle number, where the Hilbert space is a so-called Fock space. Furthermore, we can then apply operators similar to the creation and annihilation operators in the harmonic oscillator to create all these states from a vacuum state with no particles. And this then leads us towards quantum field theory. Well, the harmonic oscillator-like operators would lead to bosons, but the antisymmetrization for fermions can be enforced by adjusting the corresponding algebraic relations. With this, one can also define a number operator, which then automatically has eigenvalues 0 or 1 only. But this remark is really just for information. What is really useful for us is that with these occupations we can write the total energy of the system in states such as above as the sum over all occupied states, so let me write this down here. This still ignores interactions, but I here include the possibility that the single particle states also depend on the spin, as this is included in the index I. We will later look at the statistical properties of such occupations. But the language of occupations is of course ideally suited also for the original formulation of the Pauli principle in terms of electrons not occupying states with the same quantum numbers more than once. Pauli was led to formulate this principle in a very far-reaching setting, namely that of the periodic table of elements. So let us turn to this now.